Hello, everybody, and welcome here tonight on February 9th. And we are going to reconvene into the study session at 6:11 p.m. Dr. Schauer.
Thank you, Madam President, members of the board, and all of our staff who are here to have this conversation with us tonight. I think it's important to point out where we've been in education as far as compensation in the way that it's been applied for many, many years. I've been doing this for 38 years. And the traditional way of compensating teachers was always called steps and movement. And so what we always knew was that there was an additional step every year. It was predictable what that was going to be. It was worth a certain amount of money. And then movement was about professional growth. So in many cases, it was additional hours of graduate credit from a college or a university. And that was very standard for many, many years. And then as budgetary issues arose and we really started looking at performance-based systems, you saw school districts departing from that. We departed from it about 10 years ago. And we no longer have a salary schedule. A lot of people think we do, but we really don't. We have a schedule that places people when they come to work for us. But then after that, there is no steps in movement like we used to know it. And so in Kyrene, the board has been very clear about having a market-driven, differentiated, performance-based system. And that's what we've been moving toward for this past 10 years. And so as we bring ideas forward to you, it's keeping that spirit in mind, and so as we have this conversation tonight, I think you'll see that we are meeting that need. As we all know, compensation increases over the past 5 years or so have been scarce. There have been years of freeze and then minimal increases due to the issues that we've had with the economy. But there's this pent-up need now to take care of our employees, and I know that we're all committed to that. And of course, it has to be affordable, so that's always the challenge. But the thing I'm most proud about in Kyrene is we've built a collaborative team where everyone at this table understands where our budget is and knows a lot about state funding and how all of this impacts our ability to do anything. And I think that's a really healthy environment to have, because we take collective responsibility for what we can or cannot do with our employees. And you don't really see finger pointing from this group, and you don't really see adversarial relationships, because there's this mutual understanding, and I believe we have that with the board, that we're all after the same thing. We want to do the best we can, but we have to make sure that our kids get taken care of and all the other needs we have don't get slighted, so I think that's important. And so we had a presentation from Fox Lawson not too long ago, and the board asked for options. Fox Lawson had some things that they believe we need to do because of the market compensation issues that we face, and you said, we always like to see options. Please bring options forward that we can consider. And so that's what you're going to see tonight. And so we can have a discussion about that. I think we have a pretty good indication of where the employee groups fall, because we've had meet and confer processes going on. So we know what our employees are thinking. And Jeremy's going to represent that thinking to you in this presentation tonight. So I'll go ahead and turn it over to Jeremy.
Thank you, Dr. Schauer, Madam President. Let's go ahead and jump into it. First, want to go over a budget overview and just remind everyone of our total budget picture. And then we'll go through the compensation options, and then we're going to look at our five-year reserve plan and what we brought forward before about our spending and how we want to manage our reserves over the next 5 years. And then we're going to go into a compensation dashboard to be able to further dig into the different options and what those impacts would be. So here is a budget overview. So our original placeholder was $1.6 million for a 2% cost of living increase, and $500,000 for Fox Lawson, so $2.1 million. That was the original placeholder. The Ed Credit movement is something that we've done every year, and the performance-based retention plan is something that, although it's fairly recent, we've been continuing to do that each year, so those were also assumed that we would continue those two programs. Oh, and then also the contract days is going to be embedded in here as well, but the contract days are paid for out of classroom site fund. That's the footnote, so that doesn't really impact the reserves since that's coming out of classroom site fund. And classroom site fund has three pots. This is not the pot of money of classroom site fund. It's used for performance pay. It comes from the other two pots. All right, so option one was presented by Fox Lawson. It was designed to address recruitment and market competitiveness for entry-level salaries for positions. It is the most affordable plan. It focuses on bringing the bottom up and making the entry level more competitive. But I'll tell you that this one is the least supported by employee groups because it doesn't do much to honor the reason why there are gaps between employees that were accumulated either due to experience or education. And it doesn't do enough to support retention. It's more focused primarily on recruiting, although people who are currently working for the district and at the bottom of the scale would still be moved up with this plan. Option two is the one that's the most difficult to understand. We won't spend a lot of time trying to explain it right now, only because this one is also not the option that's being recommended by the different groups. But the focus of option two was to still address recruitment, still address bringing the bottom up, but to do it in a way that's more affordable and more manageable, and also at the same time reestablish the gaps that are naturally between employees due to experience or education. So this would bring everyone up temporarily with a stipend, but that stipend then goes away as their natural trajectory takes them past that target amount. So if we're targeting 40,000, and if we were doing nothing and someone through normal cost of living increases, normal ed credit submissions would go through that $40,000 barrier in 3 years, then this stipend would bring them to $40,000, hold them there for that three-year period, and then once they go through the $40,000 threshold, they wouldn't have a stipend anymore. And so in that short term, in that three-year period, they're caught up pretty significantly with their peers who are making more, but then over the long term, the gap that was between them and their peers is reestablished. So that'll be a little bit easier to see when we do it in the dashboard. Also included with this was to do a 1% increase to the performance-based retention plan. So that's the bump that employees get at 7 years. So all employees 7 years and up would have received an additional 1%. Option three. I'll tell you, this was most supported by the employees. And so this was, you know, as we went through the different conversations and meet and confer, and we heard the concerns on each of the plans, one of the things that was brought forward was, well, we know that you need to address recruitment, but we also want retention to be honored just as well. And so when we started looking at different ways that we could try to do that, we looked at the possibility of doing a combination of a flat percentage increase for cost of living, but also a flat dollar amount. So if we looked at a specific band, and let's say the bottom of the band, you give them a 1% cost of living increase, and then after that, it took another 50 cents an hour to get them up to what our target was, then everybody within the band would get 1% and 50 cents. When we looked at this option three, although it was very well supported by the employees, doing it in this version was just not affordable, which is what led to option four, which is basically the same thing as option three, but reducing the flat amount that's given to everyone who's above the target line in order to make the plan more affordable. So we're about to go into more details on those plans, and it'll make more sense as we go through it in the dashboard. But this again, with the $2.1 million of new spending, new and ongoing spending each year, this is where it would put us. So in the 19-20 year, we'd be at $15.1 million. So that's what we've already had discussions about. That would be a comfortable path because we're still on a plan to stay above 15 million. Obviously, between now and then, we would be still working to improve that picture, but we wanted to know that we're at least on a trajectory that didn't take us below the 15 million within the next 5 years. And also included with these numbers and included with all the other numbers that you're gonna see within the dashboard is the assumption that we would continue to do some of the things that we do every year, like the education credit movement, the performance-based retention plan, a cost of living increase. So some of those items that are typical items that we support each year are factored into and assumed that we would do some of those same items in the future years as well. All right, and here is the dashboard. I realize, you know, that you guys don't want me taking you out into Excel anymore, so if I can't take you to the tools, I'm just going to bring the tools into the presentation. So that's why we're doing it as a dashboard. So let me go ahead and get you configured to the dashboard. There are four different options. We'll go through each of the four options, and so right now we're set on options. And when we're looking at these options, what's represented in the chart is three different teachers. So this four set of bars right here, this is teacher number one and what this looks like for them over a four-year period. These four, that's teacher number two and what it looks like for them over a four-year period, and this is teacher number three. Teacher number one represents the entry level. So this is the bottom of the pay scale. Teacher number two represents someone who's already at the first year target amount. So the amount that, you know, based on our study with Fox Lawson, is the amount that we want to get employees to in the first year. Teacher number three represents your average 9-year teacher and where their current salary is. And while we're going to be talking about how this represents for teachers, the concepts, the numbers are all being applied consistently across all bands, all employee groups. So the concept is still going to be the same, but when we look through the data, we're going to be looking at how it impacts the teachers. So when we look at this, you have, you know, the teacher number one under Fox Lawson, they're at 36,204, and they would get a cost of living increase then of 724, and they would get another $888.72 for the market increase. And then plus the yellow bars is the additional days that we're planning on adding, the two additional contract days. And so what you can see from this chart is that this teacher who was, you know, previously $1,600 a year above teacher number one, they eventually become even as we do the 3-year Fox Lawson plan. That gets put into their permanent salary, and so from that point forward they would always be even, which is one of the sticking points with this plan, was because this teacher who was previously above this teacher was above them because either they had more experience or more education that warranted them getting a higher salary. And then you can see what this does in terms of them catching up with people on the higher end who wouldn't receive any market adjustment, and in terms of closing the gap between where they're at and the higher end. Now you can see that the new investment of funds in order to do this option, you know, is well within range. You can see the reserve targets over the next 5 years, and you can see that, you know, we dip a little bit into the yellow, but we're still at 19.5. We're still very strong in the fifth year. You could make adjustments to the cost of living increase and see how that changes those different projections. But with this option, even at the full 2%, we're still looking really strong in that final year. Again, this was the one that was the least supported by employees. Option two. This is the most complicated one. All right, so option two is a vanishing stipend. Right now, these current set amounts are the amounts that basically mirror what Fox Lawson was proposing that we do for teacher salaries over the next 3 years. And so they're set at 38, 40, 42. I'm going to drop these down to 38 just to try to demonstrate what this looks like once we get to a target amount where we're comfortable with saying that is what the lowest paid teacher should make. So let's say if that number was 38,000, what you would see is that with that number, this teacher gets that stipend in the first year, but that green does not roll over into being blue. That doesn't become a part of their permanent salary. Only the red and the yellow become a part of their permanent salary, and then they get cost of living off of that. And so this gap that was between them at 36,204 and 37,816, when you get into the final year, 39,749 and 38,034, that gap is reestablished after the stipend has vanished. And so that's, you know, the basic concept of the stipend. There were concerns about in the year when we finally decided where the stipend would top off. So if we said it topped off at 40 or 42,000, that the people who were receiving the stipend, although they would get cost of living, it would feel like a salary freeze to those employees because their overall compensation would not increase. So you can see that a little bit better when we make these both 40,000. So I move these up. And you can see for this employee, although they're getting a cost of living, and you see the blue bar going up, their overall total salary doesn't increase. They stay at $40,000 because that's still the target line, and so you're getting a stipend to get you to the target. This plan offered the most flexibility. However, there were still concerns about this plan, so it was not the one that was most supported by employee groups. Option three, this one was the most supported by employee groups, but you see what happens to the reserves over here in the red. This plan is very expensive. You can tell just by the size of the bars where you see the 9-year employee jumping up pretty significantly over that 3-year period. The concept of this plan was that everybody gets a cost of living increase, so $724.08 is what it represents for this employee. And then you take the lowest level employee, so that would be this employee. They need $888.72 to reach the target. So everybody gets another $888.72. So that does a lot for honoring employees and giving everybody the same increase while trying to meet the recruitment goal. However, it's unaffordable, which is why this is not the plan that we're bringing forward for recommendation. Instead, we worked on a variation of this plan, and you can see even if you drop the cost of living down, so you can go to 1.5, 1, we don't get out of the red. It makes the numbers a little bit better, but it doesn't do an overall improvement for our targets and where our targets need to be over the 5-year plan. So we made a variation of this plan. We went with option 4. And with option 4, what you can see is it's still doing cost of living. But with this one, so everybody gets that same cost of living on the flat dollar amount. So for this employee, at a 1% cost of living, they need $1,250 to be able to get to the target amount. The 50% represents that everyone else who's already above the target line then gets half of the raw dollar amount that was given to that employee. So when you get to this employee right here, that's $625 instead of the $1,250. You could look at other variations of this plan. So if you went with 1.5% and 33%, we would still be good. But you know, if you tried to go 1% and 67, you see we dip into the red. If you went 0.5% and 67, you know, you still kind of keep us above water right there. But the actual inflation increase this year is 1.04 is the final number that JLBC is going to go with for this year. And so we felt that keeping the cost of living increase in line with actual inflation was the best option. And by keeping that at 1%, then the best we can do is the 50%. If you try to push that to 67, you can see we're going to dip into the red right there. So by doing the 50%, we stay out of the red, and we make the cost of living in line with inflation.
What are the 33, 50, 67 boxes?
It's this dollar amount. So right now at 50%, that means 625 is half of the 1250. But yeah, we could do the 33 and the 67, and you could see that they would get 838 or 33, you know, then they would get 412.
So you mean to tell me that at 50 we're 16 million to the good, and at 67 we are... It's a $30 million difference?
16 to 13.
Oh, the 13 is a negative. It just means it's below 15, so
yes,
it's a bad.
That's why it's red.
Gotcha.
Yes.
Gotcha.
Less than 15 million, that's our danger zone. I do want to let you look at this data from one other perspective, other than just looking at it option by option. By switching over here to teachers, you can now look at all four options at the same time, but see how it impacts an individual teacher. So with one of our primary goals being addressing the recruitment issue, you can see, so this is all teacher one for the four different options in year one. This is year two, year three, year four, showing all four options for that teacher. So teacher one in all scenarios was beginning at 36,204. In year two, you can see that the total salary is basically about the same. Right, they all have different ways of getting there, but the overall salary for that teacher is basically the same because, again, we're trying to bring that teacher up to these set targets over the 3-year period. And so you can see for teacher one, regardless of which option we went with, we still have that same goal. We're still meeting that goal of addressing the recruitment by bringing them up to these three different levels over the next 3 years. Where it starts to get different is for the other teachers. So for teacher two, You can see that option three obviously works out better for teacher two. The other options are still fairly in line with each other. And when we get to teacher three, you can see that option three works out significantly better for teacher three than the other options. And then you can see the little variations on the other options and how they impact teacher three, which is your average 9-year teacher. So that's all the options. We can slice this up and look at it any way you'd like. I could switch back over here to options. But again, this is where we're at right now in recommendation. We can also take feedback from some of the staff that have been working with us as we develop these options, if that would help move the conversation along as well.
Thank you, Jeremy. Very good. Once again.
Better than Excel?
I think so, except okay. For, I don't know about you guys, like we couldn't get it on, we can't, you're going to have to show us how we can play with it.
Okay.
What flash wasn't on this computer, so. But I think you did a good job, so I don't think, unless Ross wants to wave it around. So, and with that, do any board members have any questions?
Well, I would like to hear feedback from Susan and Mike, or any KESPA and teachers.
Nobody likes to talk. Okay. we had an all-day work session last week with our certified meet and confer team, and the other groups have seen this plan since then, Plan 4, and they feel that this is probably the fairest way. We really are concerned. We'd like all of our teachers to make $40,000 inside of Kyrene, not just the beginning ones. As you look at that second group, we think it's important to get them up just as fast to the 40,000, not just the beginning salaries, because we know recruitment's an issue. We don't want to forget our teachers on retention. And I've had several teachers share some information with me that looks at, they just looked at their W-2 over the last 8 years. And there's other factors other than just the fixed contract amount that impact teacher salaries. There's pay for performance, which is impacted by our sales tax revenue. And then there was the career ladder program, which this was the first year that there were some of the teachers in the district no longer received that. So for them, they've seen their salaries dip and not even come back all the way up yet for those, even though we know fortunately 301 is producing more revenue and helping us with that. So that's, you know, some of the other conditions that we're looking at in the big picture. But I think that when we start to look at Plan 4 and move the numbers around, I do think that, I mean, I understand the point of staying within the $15 million as far as the bonding rate and stuff, but we really would like to pursue looking at the 67% because it dips down under by $2 million, and do we have time over the next 4 years to find that kind of revenue to take care of that? You know, teachers have gone a long time, all teachers have gone a long time, and the issue with finding teachers to fill our positions is not just about recruitment, it's about retention also. And so, and we want to do it in a fair way, and we felt that the looking at the 1% based on the inflationary, the rate of inflation was a fair way to look at that being the only amount there instead of going up to like 2%. So I think, anything else, girls?
Well, Susan said most all of it, but our meet for team went over the same things last week, and it was number four here that seemed most affordable to the district, met with retention, keeping the veteran employees, you know, recognizing them as well. 67%'s nice. I'm sure we can find $2 million, but we do like that. 67%, but 50, you know, it's affordable.
And Kyrene Administrative Council, have any different comments or? Oh. Surprise. Just kidding.
Good evening. I will try to represent my colleagues. As I heard the conversations the last couple of times that we met, and we were able to review the fourth option. We were able to review all four options there, and what struck a chord for similarity of the importance are the items that we have articulated thus far, the cost of living going across all employee groups. We can see a support in both of these options that are here. The other items of interest for the administrative team is the addressing of the market value for the administrators at the different tiers, as Fox Lawson has made recommendation. And as we talked about the programs in front of you, we did talk about the performance retention item. And Jeremy, you and I spoke quietly as we were talking about the fourth option and whether or not that item has play in the fourth option. Do you want to talk about that a little bit here?
Okay, can you hear me now? All right, for the fourth option, if we're going at the 67%, then I would strongly discourage trying to also do an increase on the performance-based retention plan, since this would be pushing us into the red already. At the 50% level, we do have some flexibility in here. So at the 50% level, we could look at doing, you know, another 0.5%, maybe even a full percent on the performance-based retention plan. And that would impact all employees that have been with the district for 7 or more years would receive an additional 1%. And all employees that have been with the district for less than 7 years would then be looking forward to, when they sign their seventh contract, they would get a 3.5% increase instead of the current existing 2.5% increase.
And with $15 million being the bar that we want to stay above for the bond ratings, and what about the good point that we could find $2 million somewhere else? I mean, this is assuming that we do the budget that you've presented, but in a, you know, budget this large, could we find $2 million to support employees?
It would, well, we'd have to do one of two things in order to do that. First one, the one that I would prefer, would be with us getting more comfortable with generating revenue outside of the regular formula. Doing things that we've talked about here before, such as sponsorship and advertisement. We have a large parcel of land that we're not leveraging to make any revenues on right now. I would like to explore bringing in additional revenues and using some of our assets and leveraging our assets to be able to close that gap. The second option, if we're not going to leverage our assets, then would be we'd have to cut from something else. So then you'd have to look at, you know, some of the other things that we have in place now, and then just start having discussions on what it is that we'd want to cut in one of those future years to be able to make up the gap. The goal was to try to use the benefit of Proposition 123 to put us into a position where we're not doing budget cuts again in a future year. If we find efficiencies in something that we're doing, or we find that something's ineffective and we want to remove it, that's fine, but we don't want to be forced to make budget cuts and start cutting more meat and bone in future years. So we're trying to manage the money in a way that we don't have to make budget cuts in a future years, and we can actually be able to have this budget sustain us while still doing things like honoring compensation increases each and every year over the 5-year plan.
Ross?
Boy, it's a lot of numbers. Let's go to the reserve slide, the one that we've been seeing for quite a while.
I need some help from the keyboard. Can I get the escape key?
He's sleeping. Oh, sorry, he's awake.
Thank you.
There you go. You know, this is one of these things that you just see it every 2 weeks, and eventually, you know, it starts to kind of get baked in your brain like it's factual, that it's something other than a projection. Let's just talk for a second about the note at the bottom. It says that the 5-year projection assumes $2.5 million of new discretionary spending each year. So what that means is that every year there's $2.5 million of new spending that gets baked in to the base M&O for the following year, and then there's a new 2.5 on top of that.
Right.
So over a 5-year period of time, that's $12.5 million of new spending that gets baked into this. So what we know is if the 5-year projection assumed $2 million of new discretionary spending each year, or $1.5 million, that $15 million would be a bigger number. That's a big, that $2.5 million assumption is a big part of what gets you to $15 million.
Correct.
Right.
But so you would have to, and also you do it over four, because it's starting the 5-year with the current existing year, 15, 16. So it's really And if we're already making the decisions for 16, 17, it's really the 3 years that would be in play. You'd be looking at those last 3 years, the 17, 18, 18, 19, and 19, 20, and talking about doing less there. But you are correct in saying that if in the final 3 years we spent $1.5 million instead of $2.5 million,
right,
then that would close the gap. But the $2.5 million includes a lot of compensation increases. That's primarily what that is. That's compensation increases in those years. So you would be talking about doing more compensation now at the expense of doing less compensation in those future years.
Okay. So we've been looking at this $15,151,000 for a number of weeks now.
Yes.
So let's go back to option four, which is $16,407,000.
Which is why we said that under this scenario, if it's at the 50%, then we can afford to go ahead and add in the performance-based retention plan increase, and we would still stay above that $15 million target. But if we go to 67%, then that's no longer a feasible option.
Right. I mean, I'll respect the $15 million just because we've been respecting the $15 million up to this point. But it would seem to me that with all the higher math that goes on in this Excel spreadsheet, you could really solve to the $15 million. You could force it to get there. If that's what you wanted to do.
In terms of...
You could, like, in other words, you've got 50 and 67, like they're the only two numbers. It could be 58, couldn't it?
That's correct.
Right. So it could be, you could just make, you could force the numbers to work if you
yes.
wanted to. Okay, I think the only other question I have, well, maybe two other questions. One is we're talking about teachers here, but, you know, when we talk about Fox Lawson, we talk about, you know, and Susie talked and Mike's here and... How does this manifest itself for KESPA and for CAC?
Every band has a target that was set by Fox Lawson over the three-year period. This plan for how teachers would be addressed in each one of those bands. So in each one of those bands, the cost of living increase is first applied at the lowest entry-level position, and then once you've applied the cost of living increase to that entry-level position, you look at the gap that's between that entry-level position now after the cost of living increase is applied versus the target number given to us by Fox Lawson. That amount is then applied to that entry-level position. Everyone above that then receives the percentage of what that gap was. So each band would see differentiated increases based on where that band's current performance is in terms of the market about.
So the English answer to that what is that
we're doing it the same way
is
for
that
all
it
of
does
them.
It manifests itself through all employee groups.
Yes.
It's not just teachers. So in other words, this 13 million whatever number is not just about
correct.
The
it's,
teacher effect.
That's
it's all the
employees.
Effect. All right. My last question is: this is like my Bernie Sanders moment here, who, by the way, won the New Hampshire primary. So for those
spoiler
of you that,
alert.
For those of you that, exactly.
That taped it and thought God, they were
going
to go home and watch
it. I was DVRing that. Show me the difference in dollars between the 15-16 for teacher one and the 15-16 for teacher three. 42,735 versus... The 15-16 difference between teacher
okay.
one and teacher two. 42,735, and now go way to the left. 36, so 60...
65,531.
$6,500?
Yeah.
Okay, so now go to the fourth year for those teachers. What's the difference? 45,800. It's narrowed.
Yes.
So this would be Bernie Sanders' solution, the kind of the income redistribution that everybody needs to kind of come to the middle so that the rich don't get richer. Now, I actually think that this may be a good idea. That doesn't mean I'm supporting Bernie Sanders, but I do think this is a good idea. But it does seem to me that there isn't a lot of reason for that gap to get smaller. I mean, I was ready to make the argument that the gap shouldn't get wider, but now they're really kind of clustering to the middle. So my idea here that there might be a number between 50 and 67 that solves to the 15, I mean, it's a lot of variables, but I mean, for what little I do understand of this, you know, it's a lot of it sounds intuitively like it makes some sense, but I think there's some fine tuning that can kind of take care of making sure that, you know, my point always was in the past that if you gave a flat percentage increase to everybody, somebody who makes 100,000 versus somebody may, that it, all you're doing is widening the gap. But here they're kind of clustering towards the middle a little bit too much. So there might be a way to kind of keep the 6,500 or something close to that over time by using a little bit more of the reserves. You understand what I mean? Finding a number between 50 and 67 where the $6,500 difference now becomes a $5,000 difference. Maybe it stays closer to 6,500.
Okay. It would, by closer, I mean it would be relative. If we did a number where, because this is showing the 67% right now, so under the 50%, that gap is actually
right,
bigger.
Right, but we know if we were solving to 15,151,000, the number somewhere between 50 and 67.
Which means the gap would be bigger than what's being displayed right here on the screen.
And I think the gap can be
bigger. The gap would be smaller than what it is being displayed on screen. Because at the 67% level where...
I get that. But there may be some nuance of the variables that kind of gets closer to... This is kind of fine-tuning.
So let's say if we did this. So if we did a 0% cost of living increase and then 67%, then at that level... you'd see 45,506 and, you know, 40,000. So it's 5,500. So that would be one way you could do it, and that would also keep you above 15 million.
You have weeks to do this. So, you know, I think that, you know, depending what the board wants to do, I think there is kind of some philosophical goals you can have here that have to do with equity, not widening the gap, but not making it too narrow either. So that's my contribution.
Mr. King?
My point's probably a little off point, but I'll ask it anyhow. It seems to me that the years of experience plays into this only up to a certain point. Am I reading that right?
It's years of experience and education that play into the numbers, yes.
Okay, so, and then the other thing, what we're looking at here is what I would consider the base, right? Because there's additional compensation for performance and that sort of thing.
Yes, performance pay comes out of classroom side fund, and the performance pay amount is the same for all teachers.
Say that again?
The performance pay is paid for out of classroom side fund, and the performance pay amount is all teachers have the ability to earn the maximum performance pay.
Okay.
It gets differentiated based on their actual performance, but
sure.
The 2,500 is something that's put into place teachers.
And all right, and then that's why I asked about the years of experience thing, because it seems to me what you're saying is an entry level. What you want to do after 4 years is make sure that they're on par with those who may have started out when they started with more experience or something like that.
The goal with the entry level is we had Fox Lawson do a study, and what we tasked Fox Lawson with is we adopted a blueprint goal that said we would be in the 67th percentile for compensation. The three-year plan gets us into the 67th percentile for all employees by the time we close the third year. And so to make it manageable, we had to make it a three-year plan to make it more affordable. And we're trying to make sure that we meet those targets, those
okay.
three-year targets.
All right,
to get to that level.
And I think I'm getting closer to my answer. I start today, right? 3 years from now, I've got 3 years. When I started, there were already teachers here. So whatever number of years they had when I came on board, they've got three more years. They're still my senior with
yes.
more experience. But at that point in time, based on this plan, we should be par.
No. No, so like when you see, you'll be close. So you'll see this person right here basically has either the second group right here, if I can get my mouse to start working right. Really? There it goes. Let me put this back up to one. Yeah. Thing is not liking me right now. All right, here we go. 1 and 50%. All right, so... this person right here is starting, you know, above this other person, either because they have a couple more years of experience or they could have had, you know, an additional degree. Their education put them higher. When they get into this final year, 40,093, 43.76. They're really close. It doesn't necessarily put them back to even. Option one would have made them even.
Yeah, well, that's
under
what
option
I said
four. There's part. Still some gap. The gap is just closed.
Okay.
There's a lot of compacting at the bottom of the salary schedule with this plan.
Okay. And the teachers are okay with this.
Maybe we should go back to steps and movement. Is that a bad idea?
I just want to make sure.
Well, I think that one of the things that all teachers are looking up is really increasing everyone's salary, but it really changes a lot for the teachers, because once you are in the profession, the very best thing a teacher can do, which is really difficult to do now because of the cost, is to get your master's degree, because you're moving along with your educational credits at the same time. As public schools, our goal is to be lifelong learners too. If our teachers don't continue professional development, you will start to see people pass over other people, just because other people take district-level professional development, take courses from universities, get masters, get double masters, get doctoral degrees, and that's what we really support with that educational credit money, where we always honor that. And so I think that one of the things is, it's not, after a certain point in the system, it's after a few years, it's not really just about your experience. It's about your experience and your continued education. And so that's one thing. And that's how you can't really compare apples to apples, because, like, I, you know, when I look at the salary increases, we want all teachers to go up. We want all teachers to increase their salary. But what we're very concerned about right now is actually helping some people that are only coming in because they don't even make enough money. We have teachers working way too many second-time jobs. And we feel that you need to make at least $40,000 to even be able to, I don't know, pay the rent and, you know, get to work, because you get some gas money. At least gas is cheaper now, but you know what I'm saying? And so there's a lot of conditions in here that impact that. So before, you just got moved along. If you still get your increases, which would be considered like your 1% or whatever in the old system. This here is, it really doesn't build in just tenure. It has other factors. And then the performance pay that you asked about is a totally entire different system than what this is.
Sure.
So.
Okay, thanks.
But, yeah, we're trying to support.
And this is why Bernie Sanders is catching on, because of that answer. That you have that at the base, there's got to be some living wage. That I think that's what you're saying.
Yeah, I'm not even sure. I mean, I make a bit more than $40,000, and if I didn't have a second income in my household, I mean, it would be really difficult to keep a roof over your head and a car to drive in to get to work.
So,
you know?
Oh, absolutely. Just to clarify, this option four gives us that base that you're
the teacher support option four. What we haven't really figured out is the whole difference. We do really support the COLA increase to stay with the cost of living increase, because we think that really just indicates, you know, where we are, you know, and it's at the 1.04, just call it 1%, because that's easier. What we really haven't really talked a lot about is whether it's at the 57 or the 67%, or if it's at the 50%, because this is, you know, to look at the possibility of that 7-year bump. We are really concerned about retaining our teachers in Kyrene. Mm-hmm. They are our most valuable asset after, you know, as we continue to educate them and give them professional development and support them. So that's the other part of it, is that retention
as we go along.
But
to your earlier point, if you never attract them, you can't ever retain them.
You can't never retain them. That's
so,
right.
You know, there's got to be that element. Just one of the real quick questions. Were you done, John? Was that? Okay. So the other thing we're solving for is this, you know, the first slide. So presumably, you know, the whole approach on this was we were solving to having more than $15 million in reserves at a point in time. But on this one, it speaks to $1.6 million and $500,000. So that option works here as well.
All of these assume all of those. So all of these are already assuming the numbers that we've already discussed, including the most recent change for the middle school electives and moving that number up to the 870. That's all assumed into these numbers.
Those are just the numbers on that page that he was talking about. Those are just the teacher numbers, or is that across
no,
the board?
No, this is the entire district right here.
Okay.
So this is all employees when you're looking at the reserve numbers and everything else. This is assuming that whatever approach we take, we're taking the same approach for all employees. For visual purposes, the charts are only reflecting teachers, just to show you what the impact is on teachers. But the idea is that whatever approach we take is an approach we take for all employees.
Okay.
And so they all have their own different targets.
So I want to, just before we wrap up here, I did have a couple things. When we talk about, you know, and this came up, I'm thinking it was 4 years ago when we did give that one-time stipend because it was like one-time funding. One thing that I always, you know, like to caution us on is that anytime any sort of funding that we do that, whether it be for, you know, sale of a land or something that's maybe not as stable, that I really feel comfortable when we do a compensation increase, when we're using funding that we, for the most part, because it's been kind of a crazy ride here, but that it's funding that we can rely on, that we, for the most part, know that it's going to be consistent. And then we kind of work around all of the other pieces to this budget line item. So, you know, I think that that's something that, you know, if we get chunks of money in of amounts that we aren't expecting, to me, those are items where we would use a one-time funding source, like i.e. like a curriculum or something of the sort. So that's just something that, you know, I'd like to point out as far as whenever we make a commitment regarding compensation, it needs to be with really stable or the most stable funding we can have. The other question that I have, just because it may come up, is with the administration piece of it, which is the Fox Lawson that you had talked about, I know this was for all employee groups. Now, could this be, and it would be something later because obviously it's not on here, but with that administration piece, obviously the amounts that they get are going to be considerably higher because the base salary is higher. Would that be something where you could fluctuate that percentage chart? Maybe that's a little lower for the first year while we, and again, I don't know what kind of numbers those are, and if it's significant in the big scheme of things.
You're talking about the cost of living piece?
Well,
or?
Because Fox Lawson, I mean, it was, you know, they've given their recommendations. We've kind of followed, I guess, the three-year recommendation of the percentage of being 67% or above. But what I'm saying is kind of like when you're giving an administrator that 2% increase, it's considerably higher than a teacher's 2% increase. So what I'm saying is when we're looking at not the standard everyone gets increase, but I'm talking about the specific piece, the Fox Lawson piece, what kind of numbers are we talking there?
It really varies based on the position and how out of line the position is in terms of competing with the market. But the one thing I will add is, while that might seem like a good approach, like it would actually stretch far, you have to remember that there's 1,075 teachers, and we have, what, about 89 administrators?
That's correct.
So, you know, when you start talking about making a cut to what you want to do with administrators to try to spread it across teachers, it has to be a pretty deep cut before it has any meaningful impact on bringing up what we could do for the teacher salary, just because of the sheer difference of the numbers of employees who fall into those two different groups.
Well, and I think it's just a question that people ask us, so it's, we have to ask you.
Well, and to that point, I had a suggestion that you, and Leela could do this, provide us with the date that we had the Fox Lawson presentation. And I know when I was first on the board, it seemed like it was 6-7 years ago that we had a Fox Lawson presentation, not the one we're talking about now, but and we actually received the data that showed how far off some positions were. And I think, if I remember correctly, that led to some of the changes in the allied health
yes.
people. So for me, and maybe other board members that are new or hadn't seen that, or just for reference, if we could have the date of that presentation and maybe a little background on how Fox Lawson got to those target numbers. And I get that there are fewer administrators, but we I would think still have the goal that we want to keep our administrative costs lower than other districts. And so let's just assure us that we're still keeping that philosophy as well. So does that make sense? Just some Fox Lawson background? And
yeah, Mrs. Hirsch, we can certainly send you the date of that presentation, and we can also send you the salary schedules that Fox Lawson developed. Just a reminder that Of course, teachers is pretty easy to talk about because it's just one band, and we know that teachers at the entry level are about 12% off market, less so at the midpoint at the in the end of the range. But for some administrative positions, not all, that can be as great as 20% off market. So I think if you actually take a look at the detail in the Fox Austin plan, you'll see that there are some administrative positions actually significantly off market, below market.
And what's been helpful in the past is for me to understand how that works with your department. How, you know, are we having administrators leave? Is it difficult to recruit when you have a position? That kind of thing. We know from our review of personnel action items that we have lots of teachers leaving. I don't see lots of administrators leaving. Maybe they're talking about it, or maybe they... other districts have the same problem. I don't know, but it would help to put it into context, because we do understand teachers so much better because we have the information that we, you know, review every week that more are leaving, and we hear about salaries compared to other districts and the trouble attracting teachers. But it would help to hear it with all the employee groups. Are we having trouble attracting support staff? Are we having trouble attracting principals when they're openings, that kind of thing? For me, that would be helpful.
Yeah, and our overall attrition is just over 10%. So for the teachers, that would mean when you see 100 teachers leaving, or over 100 teachers leaving, you know, that 10%, when it works out on the administrative side, would only mean 8 administrators or 9 administrators leaving in order to meet that same 10%. So, I mean, it's not as simple as just looking at the raw numbers. You got to look at you know, the percentages, since there's such a vast difference in the number of people who are in each category.
President Coggins, can I say a few things?
Sure.
Now that I have my feet on the ground, thanks for the surprise earlier this evening. Let's see if I can be a little bit more eloquent. You have actually 2 survey results in your board docs that, given some time to review the information in there, some of the questions that you're asking is really, what are the stakeholders' perceptions? How do they feel about these models? What's important to them? And I'm going to add some voice to our colleagues. I actually sit on the certified meet and confer team, and we have some shy members sitting at this table that I'd like to speak on their behalf. The survey was very well received for our certified staff, our teachers, as well as for the administrators. And you'll see repeat resonance for items that are of importance and value to them. First and foremost, we are asking that we support a COLA increase across all positions, ESP, administrator, and certified staff. That allows us to buy groceries at the same rate that we're able to buy this year, and it's supportive of all of us, and I've enjoyed the voices of the table in front of me as far as saying, hey, let's be minimal there. We simply want to keep up with the current market of costs that our lives have so that we can keep on in a way that works for our families as well as for our kids that join us on a daily basis. The second are some nuances that you're really seeing in this fourth model. Let's support being able to bring in new employees to the system, whether they are ESP administrator or teachers. We really are asking that we bring up their salaries to market value, and we're asking us to hit the target of the 67th percentile. In some of the earlier models, which we didn't bring to the table for the conversation, so I'm going to add some voice here, in the Fox Lawson review, they gave us some feedback that shared with us that those who are sitting at the middle and the higher ends of the salary were over market value. So the fourth model offers a nice blend to saying those of us who are returning for a continuing year, we absolutely want to compensate and increase your compensation to ask you to return and to make you feel good about that. So that trick between the 50 and the 67%, we are asking that we go as high as we can and still remain our fiduciary responsibility as far as being able to have credit. But that difference of percentage between the 50% of that 1200 marker or the 58% of that 1200 marker makes a difference for the employees who are returning, and you'll see that ask in their survey results. Again, once you have time to really kind of get into it and marinate over the responses that you see there. Also, the retention is focused. You'll hear that voice with the respondents in the survey saying, if you could look at that 7-year hit for retention performance pay, we'd like you to consider it. So in an earlier model, Jeremy had actually added that so that you could see the effect of it on our bottom line. And in today's conversation, he's added voice to it. But it would be nice to be able to actually see it visually so that we can look at that third group of employees across all bands and say, you know what, we are going to recognize the return and your performance thereof and offer some compensation to it. In the two groups of the results that you see, there's some other variations as far as what their interests are. But in this fourth model, you see a very lovely blend of things that have importance to the stakeholders who are sitting in front of you, who are joined in their voices across the different groups as to ways that we can offer support for contract compensation. Is that helpful to know that there's a little bit of voice back there in your files that, given some time to reflect on that, you can...
So can I steal your word marinate?
Yes, you can. I share.
You know, I think that this is the first time we've been able to see this, mm-hmm. and Jeremy will make sure that we all have Flash at home on our computers so he can walk us through it. But what I'm suggesting is that the board members go look through, formulate some questions. Maybe we can get them to Leela where everyone knows what each person's questions are, because then we can... you know, get a little bit more in depth with Jeremy and Mark on some of the questions that we have so we can start to move forward, because it's a lot of information, as you all know. And I think when Ross is a little bit confused, maybe, sort of, then I don't feel so bad if I'm vocal to say that some of this I'd like to probably get in touch with Jeremy over, just playing with it a little bit. So again, I appreciate everyone coming out tonight, and thank you for the presentation. And I do really like this, Jeremy, I think better than the Excel sheet. But again, I think we'll have some further questions to move forward. So with that, we are going to conclude the study session, and we will take a 5-minute break and reconvene for the board meeting. Thank you.